Welcome to the Leaderonomics show. Today we have with us one of the most amazing leaders around, Dato Sri Idris Jala, the former CEO and leader at Malaysian Airlines and a number of Shell organizations. Dato Sri, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Leadership is one of those things, it's very hard to become a really good leader, right? How did you become your leader? How did you begin your leadership journey?
I think these things evolve over time. Okay. And I don't think there's ever any point when I look at my life that suddenly at that point I became a leader. And okay. I think it's something that evolved over time. Okay. And in that point of evolution, I can recall at times there were moments when I felt that the evolution was moving into transformation.
Okay.
And so I think in my career, the moment when I felt that I was moving out from an evolution to a transformation in my leadership style was when I went to Sri Lanka, actually.
Okay. So what happened in Sri Lanka?
I was faced with a job. Okay. I was thrusted into a job where I kind of felt that everything that I've learned in Shell, I couldn't apply them there. And I knew that if I had used the old tricks,
just won't work.
It wouldn't work.
Okay.
I'm going to fail if I did that. So I really have to step back and ask the questions. What do I need to do differently to cause this to happen?
Okay.
And I just had to really come outside of my skin to find another way to do it. The
right.
process of changing the way that I did things and approached problems really became transformational for myself.
Okay.
If you remember the renowned American psychologist, and William James, he said, the greatest discovery of our present day generation is that human beings can alter their lives by changing their state of mind.
Yep, exactly.
So at that moment, I kind of felt that I have to change my state of mind by saying, this impossible task, it can be made possible, but I have to throw away all my
previous beliefs
and ways of doing it. And I have to now discover something entirely new. Mm. And that very act of doing this new thing was transformational.
Yep. And so you grew as a leader in some way or form?
Yes. I evolved into a leadership role. I was already the CEO of Shell Sri Lanka then. But I realized all the things that I've learned, I have to discard them.
And you seem to have done that many, many times, taking on impossible tasks.
Yeah.
You know, Sri Lanka, I think
you went to
the UK after that, right?
Yes, right. I was I had two jobs in the UK. I was the vice president for retail marketing. That means the entire retail marketing for Shell station worldwide. I was in charge of them, so operating in 100 countries. Mm. And I was also the vice president for business development, which meant that I had a team about 60 in-house consultants.
Wow. Okay.
We got sent into Shell's operation worldwide where there was problem
and I was
in charge of that team.
Okay.
It was like a SWAT team.
Okay.
And so the beauty of that role that I had was we got sent into places where there was trouble.
Mm.
And so me and my team. So I could sense that some of the leaders in Shell where we operated, there's a streak in all those people that succeeded.
Mm.
And they were different from the ones that didn't succeed.
And what was the difference?
And that was, it's about, the first one is about what I call the game of the impossible.
Okay.
Wanting to do something that everybody else says cannot be done.
Okay.
That is the key.
And that's a hallmark of great leaders.
Yeah.
Okay.
When everybody else says it cannot be done and that guy says we can do it.
Yeah.
And you can't just say it because you want to make other people happy.
Right.
You must have the belief, the conviction.
Yeah.
But conviction, to my mind, is the centerpiece of great leaders.
Mm.
But then this point about conviction has to be fed.
Mm.
You don't let conviction by itself, then you die.
Mm.
The conviction is fed by your ability to get and harness people and get them to do the best they can.
Yeah. And so
that's the first one, the hallmark. There are many other secrets.
What would the other one?
The other one in a corporation is to that everything you do must be anchored on the profit and loss statement.
Okay.
I always believe that if you don't anchor everything, you lose priorities.
Okay.
So prioritization is absolutely key. And I've always said if it does not improve the profit and loss statement in profitability sense, it's not my priority.
Okay.
And that needs to be very brutal.
Okay.
And the third principle of leadership, to my mind, is the issue around discipline of action. There are two very important words there.
Okay.
Discipline
and action.
And action.
Yep.
And if you do not have action, you just keep on thinking about it, you have
nothing
a problem.
Happens.
Nothing happens.
Yep, exactly.
And yes, even if you act on it, but it's not discipline, That's also a problem because you act on it sporadically.
Right.
You're not doing it based on the schedule.
Right.
And that's very important. Then the fourth one is about situational leadership. I always believe when you start a journey of a change or transformation, you need to be highly directive in the style.
Right.
And as the troops begin to become competent at doing it,
you change your style.
You change your style.
Okay.
Then you become much more empowering.
Okay.
The empowerment exists when there's competency within within the troops and the staff to then do that.
Yep. Yep.
And so I do believe great leaders must have the ability to change their leadership repertoire, change from being directive to more empowering.
Okay.
But you can't tell everyone from the moment you start a journey, you tell everyone, I'm going to empower everybody to do it.
Yep.
That's a neat panacea for disaster.
Right. Right.
And so you have to be very clear when you start the journey, you need to be a good directive. Now, and I think the fifth secret, as I put them in the way I think about leadership, is to make sure that you go and get what I call winning coalition. Because no one can do it alone.
Winning, getting a team,
Getting a team and waiting all the stakeholders buy into what you're doing, engaging the public, engaging customers, the unions, and a lot of people. In the government, it's a big role, getting public acquiescence. I always tell people, making changes in government is always tied to political will. But political will is a function of public support and public acquiescence. So if there is no public support, you wouldn't have the public political will to do it.
Yeah.
And so that winning coalition is absolutely
critical.
Key. Even I do believe that even with competitors, you can collaborate with competitors. So when you deal with competitors, I would believe that the winning combination is to do collaboration and competition at the same time, provided you know exactly
what you
what the boundaries.
Yeah,
the boundaries.
The collaboration.
Say the area of oil and gas.
Yep.
I've always maintained the view in oil and gas industry, the reservoir is the area for competition, and the pump station is an area for competition. Everything along the line, you should think about collaboration.
Yep.
Pipelines collaborate on it because you bring down unit cost.
Correct, yes.
And refineries, you can collaborate.
Yep.
Ships, you can collaborate.
Yep.
But you compete for customers, you compete for reserves.
Yep.
All along the line, you cut down the cost.
Mm.
So if you can do that, then you work with competitors and say, well, let's cut down the cost jointly.
Right.
But once we cut down the cost, we shoot each other on first sight to get the best customers.
Okay.
That's what you then do. Competition, I think, is very important.
Yep, yep, yep. And what's the final point?
And the final point, I think, is very important. They don't teach this in Harvard Business School and on IMD, they don't teach it, and certainly. It is about divine intervention.
Okay, divine intervention, what's that?
That is simply because more than 60% of what happens to us got nothing to do with us.
Okay, maybe uncontrollable.
Yeah, uncontrollable.
Yep.
So let me put an example. If you can put out a piece of paper and wrote down all the major things that happened in your life and ask the question, did every single event in my life happen the way they did because I caused them to happen? If the answer is yes, I put a tick. If the answer is no, I put a cross and count them.
Right.
I guarantee you'll have more crosses.
Okay, that's
in
probably
my,
true.
In my case, 70% of on things on my sheets got nothing to do with me.
Right.
They just happened the way they did. Some people say this happened because of God, if you're religious.
Mm-hmm.
Some people say it's feng shui. Some people say it's fate. Some people call it luck. So the reason why this is important is the following. If you do all the secrets as I described, number one, number two, number three, number four, and number five, you can still fail.
Yeah, because they're uncontrollable.
Because of the uncontrollable.
Yep.
The key point here is that if you have done your best, and if the troops have done their best, you don't shoot them if they do not deliver the result.
Mm.
And so that's the beauty. And you don't get into a problem of self-flagellation too.
Yeah, yeah.
Because you realize you've done your best.
Yes.
And it gives you peace of mind.
Right.
All leaders must have peace of mind and calm.
Right.
So amidst the storm, when you're managing a business that's going through a crisis, everybody will look to the boss.
Yeah.
Is the man unflustered?
Right.
Is he calm under pressure?
Right, right.
And that is a state of mind.
That permeates.
That permeates through. Yeah, and that's what you need to do. If you're a leader, you must be looking like you're in control.
Even though your heartbeat is...
and this point about the heartbeat is that you will have that and it's real if inside you, you imbue this point about divine intervention. Mm. Now, to my mind, how do you get God to work in your favor or fate or feng shui or luck?
Yeah, how do you?
How do you do that? And I come with three things I propose.
Okay.
The first one is that you must be a good human being.
Okay.
I don't think there are good leaders exist if they are not good human beings. To my mind, the essence of being good is if you do good things, good will come upon you.
Your way. Okay.
If you do evil, evil will come upon you. One way or another, you'll get caught with it. Yep. So that's the first thing.
Okay.
Second, in business, is the issue about doing ethical things. Follow ethics, the right business ethics. Mm. It is absolutely important because, you know, what's legal, what's illegal, what's corrupt, what's, you know, somewhere in the middle, there's the issue around ethics.
Yes.
And I do believe ethics, you will make the right decisions as ethical on the basis of your conscience.
Mm.
And now, if you do something that's gray, I call the things in the middle, not quite black, not quite white, but in the gray, never make the decisions on your own.
Mm.
If I'm the MD of a company and I'm now tackling an issue that's gray, I always take it to the board and we discuss it with all the facts on the table. And then we document it. And when you document it, it becomes quite clear to you.
Why that decision?
Why now out of option one and two and three, you took option three because it's the best of all the not so good options. Because you're stuck with those parameters.
Exactly.
Now, the reason why I say you take it into the board, you never decide on your own and you do an audit trail is the reason is this. If you bring it there, you are now managing the gray issues in the white zone, not in the black. You don't keep it there. The reason is this. If you decide on ethical issues on your own, over time, your conscience gets modified.
That's true.
If your conscience get modified,
you start to believe it.
You start to then say this is the right thing to do. Before long, you graduate into the black zone.
That's true.
So that's the white, the gray, and the black zone. So I always believe that you do not stand in the gray to solve the gray. You move into the white to solve it
the gray.
With a lot of people
together
with you and do a full documentation. Mm. And the third thing that you need to do to cause the good things to come to you, the forces to come to you, is to go through what I call self-renewal. We are all so busy running around doing many different things. Now, if you come down to a period of solitude, that means loneliness is different from solitude. Loneliness is to be alone when you don't want to be alone. Solitude is you choose to be alone in deep reflection.
Correct, yes.
It is at the time you begin to look at yourself.
Mm.
If I now look at what I'm doing, what am I doing wrong?
Mm.
And many times we're busy running around, we don't have enough time to reflect.
Yeah.
And I always tell people, we must find time to reflect.
It's
and that
critical.
Reflection is to say, can I now sit down quietly and look at myself very critically? What am I doing right?
Yes.
What am I doing wrong?
Yep.
And so if you spend time doing that as a leader, you'll find and you discover there are so many things that are suboptimal in what we do.
Yeah, that's true.
And that reflection is very important. Yeah. I call that the reflection is about self-renewal.
Mm.
It's you sit down and reflect in order to renew yourself and recharge.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's something you must do regularly.
Yeah. In fact, all great leaders I notice, you know, that I interview, talk about solitude and reflection as something very critical.
Yeah.
Was it very hard for you? I mean, you kept moving jobs.
Yes.
You know, every time you did something, and I think you did it relatively well, you know, you sort of moved to a new role. Was that purposely for you to continue your growing, or was it, you know, one of those things that you were just addicted to the fact that you love change?
Yeah. I always kind of felt that if I want to transform myself and become a better leader, I must subject myself to something that each time I do it,
you're learning.
I kind of felt I couldn't do it.
Okay.
So the very fact that I go out into an environment where I think I'm going to fail, it means I have to do something really radical to deal with this.
Right.
And so I remember when I used to work in Shell for 23 years, oil and gas is very different from aviation.
Yep.
When I walked into Malaysia Airlines, the company had 3.5 months of cash. And people have said, the old ways of doing a job was take 3 months, learn the job, then only make the changes. There was no time to learn because By three and a half months, there's no more airlines.
Okay, more airlines, yep.
We had no cash to pay the salaries of the employees. There's no cash to pay for fuel in the aircraft. So essentially, my first town hall was day one. And I had to tell everybody, starting from tomorrow, we got to do this and we got to do that. Yep. And that's a tough act. And I have never done that in my entire life before that.
Mm.
That means turning into the job, day one, turn up to tell the board, this is what we will do. And that same day, tell the staff and the union, this is what we will do. And I have never worked in the aviation industry before.
Yeah.
So really,
it's
when you start...
It's a huge learning curve.
It is a learning curve. And you asked me the question at that time, was I sure that we will succeed? Absolutely not.
Yeah.
But was I sure that we will have those actions? I was absolutely sure this was the right thing that we had to do. And no guarantee for success. But the other one thing I knew was, if we make the changes, if we were not delivering the results within 1 week, I was going to change. And be prepared to make the changes along the way.
Right.
And that's how you get big results fast.
Right. So, I mean, you've really done some impossible things like the turnaround of Malaysian Airlines.
Yes.
Do you think trying to turn around the government is something that's really, really
possible? Well, when I came here, everybody said, you must be crazy with this. There's no way we can do that. And so when we ran the lab, so we came out with the government transformation program, we ran a town hall session. 13,000 Malaysians came to the town hall sessions to hear what we were going to do.
Right.
Let me tell you what the public opinion was, the feedback we received from the 13,000. 84% of them said great stuff, like the government transformation program.
Right.
75% of them said supported all the initiatives within there.
Right.
The next question was, are you confident that the government can deliver? They said yes, 71%, but in 100 years. So they did not believe. They did not believe that we could deliver this in the timeline that we laid out in the book.
Right.
We were very specific in the book about what we were going to deliver within year one, year two, and year three.
Right.
And so people have said, you're crazy, Idris. Right. How come you put such promises so public? And the reason why we did is very simple.
Mm.
The Prime Minister and the Cabinet and myself, when we sat down to discuss this, we took the view that if we came out boldly and make the promises so concrete, we have effectively made ourselves totally pregnant.
Mm.
When you're pregnant, there's only one consequence, you got to deliver.
Yep.
You got no choice because we made it so public.
Right.
And so, did we fear failure? Of course.
Right.
Because there is no room for failure now. We got to go and deliver. I can tell you this, in 1 year of implementation, we've written now a book which we issued out to the public.
And the results are phenomenal, right?
Phenomenal.
Right?
In 1 year, we achieved 112% of the set key performance indicators.
Amazing.
And the data was validated by PricewaterhouseCoopers.
Yep.
And we have an international panel to review that work from IMF representative, from the UK government, from Australia, from Transparency International co-founder. It's also in South Korea.
Right. So at the heart of it, leadership is the key to success, right?
I believe
from your life, you know, everything you touch, the impossible has become possible because of your leadership, right? In some way and form, right?
Inherently, I do believe two things.
Yeah.
I honestly believe that in any organization, including the government, there are enough talents there.
Mm.
And so that's one.
Mm.
So what you need to do is to make sure you get the leadership to harness that talent.
Yeah.
So that's one point. Yep. The second point is this. Within that organization, you'll find that people already knew the answers all this while.
Mm.
The only reason why they could not turn those ideas to result was because of the roadblocks.
Mm.
So in the labs, we specifically look for the roadblocks.
And try to remove
them. What are the roadblocks? And try and remove them.
Mm.
And so the roadblocks are bureaucracy, procedures.
Mm.
Roadblocks are processes. Roadblocks are not enough money granted onto it.
Mm-hmm.
Roadblocks are silos. Those kinds of roadblocks. Yep. They are political roadblocks, they're technical roadblocks.
Yep.
Now, if you focus the leadership intervention to remove the roadblocks, you'll be surprised how much can be delivered.
Yep.
Because everyone knew what the solutions were all this while.
Mm.
Frankly, we run labs lasting 6 weeks to 8 weeks, and we put all the people inside the room.
Mm.
I can tell you, every time we ran the labs, in the first 2 days, the answer is already on the table.
Right.
So the question, how do you remove the roadblocks? Mm. And so we focus on removing the roadblocks to cause those answers to translate themselves from ideas to results.
So where did you learn all this leadership? I mean, that was that an inspirational figure? You know, I knew you spoke about your grandfather before once.
Yeah. My grandfather and my dad, actually, they both have this idea that always expect the worst, but aim and plan for the best.
Hmm.
So that's a phenomenon about if you want to do something and you must paint a really difficult picture.
Hmm.
And so in my time, even though the situation is not bad, we will say, well, what is the worst case scenario?
Right.
And if you have the worst case scenario, what are the things we need to do
right.
to make sure we avoid that worst case
right.
scenario?
Right.
Now, you don't need to do that if you turn into a company that is very sick.
Right.
Because it's already there.
You're already there.
So you don't need to build the case for change if it's already your dire straits, your back's against the wall.
Mm.
And so those kind of things that from my dad and my parents, they were very important aspects
lessons.
Of how to do that. Now,
learning leadership at a young age. Huh?
And I read a book written by Tracy Goss.
Mm.
And this was a book I read in when I was in Sri Lanka.
Yeah.
And this book is called The Last Word on Power.
Right.
This book gave me a lot about how to deal with the game of the impossible.
Mm.
What do you need to do that? Some of the very important lessons inside that book is when you approach something that's impossible, discard your winning strategy.
Mm.
Throw away the things that you used to do before.
Right.
The very fact that they were helping you to win, that means that what you're attempting to do is actually possible.
Right.
But if you're going to do something truly impossible, that means there is no precedence.
Exactly. Yeah.
You didn't do it before.
Yep. Yep.
So that means you must be prepared to throw away your winning strategy and discover a new winning strategy.
Okay.
And that's very tough.
Okay.
Very tough. Because human beings usually we rely on precedence, our past,
yep,
and we
exactly.
don't want to create new.
If you know, quick last two questions. If I'm a college, university graduate, you know, just coming out in the workforce, you know, wanting to make a difference in the world, what couple of pieces of advice would you give me?
I would say two things.
Mm.
First of all, pursue the game of the impossible.
Okay.
Set impossible targets. When I say it's impossible, that student must say he cannot do it.
Mm.
And his friends must say
he cannot do it.
You're crazy, you can't do it. His parents must say he can't do it.
Right.
And all the people around him must say he cannot do it.
Yep.
And once he said, then everybody else, that's an impossible target.
Okay.
Now, having declared that, the second advice would then be, having now done this, make it public that you intend to do this, and then pursue the second thing called discipline of action.
Mm.
You must take actions based on that and be disciplined in doing it.
Mm.
Every little thing, and I always believe, life is tough.
Mm.
You need hard work.
Yes.
You need to really go through the mill.
True.
I don't think
and it's,
luck doesn't just fall, but
you
got to do, you work and work and work. So I think that, of course, I talk about the six secrets for the young graduate. I only focus on those two.
What if I was a CEO?
Yeah.
What advice would you give me of a company?
Same thing. I would return to the six secrets. I honestly believe 90% of human beings, we get buried underground, not achieving our full potential.
Mm.
The reason is this. Because we all fear failure.
Mm.
Because we fear failure, we never attempt to do the game of the impossible.
Mm.
And because we don't attempt the game of the impossible, we don't go through a transformation to achieve our full potential.
Yeah. Yeah.
So we go and take the mediocre route.
Right.
The road that is trodden by everybody.
Right.
The road less traveled, we avoid doing it. And that road is the one that's transformational.
Exactly,
And so if you take that, the problem today is that many leaders, they are so risk averse. And so they are always worried about failure. And they punish failure.
Mm.
I always believe that failure, when it comes in attempting to achieve the game of the impossible, it's fantastic.
Yeah.
Because it's a
learning
curve. It's a learning curve.
It's the stepping stone to transformation. Yep. You know, thanks so much for your time today. We've been speaking to Dato Sri Idris Jala here on the Leaderonomics Show. Dato Sri, thank you again for your time here with us.
Welcome.